Hi, I'm Janine Truitt. I am the Chief Innovations Officer for Talent Think Innovations, LLC. And I'm joined with Candice Morgan of Pinterest and Harsha. Jalihal of Unilever. So I'm just going to let them kind of introduce themselves a bit because I think that's important and I can't do it as well. And then we'll hop into a really nice conversation, hopefully, about diversity and inclusion.
A portion of my time focused on recruiting and finding new ways to plug people in and create access into the tech industry, which I think is one of the biggest challenges for tech, creating those newer pathways. Irregardless of relationship or pedigree or who you know. I spend another chunk of my time focused on creating inclusive, fair processes and systems to help people advance and belong across the organization. And then I spend another portion of my time focused on our product and making sure that there's a more inclusive search experience on Pinterest.
Awesome.
Hi, I'm Harsha Jalihal. I am VP of HR Future of Work at Unilever, which is a very fancy title. You know, we're trying to make something out of nothing, as I like to say. I've been with Unilever for 4 years, previously as the head of HR for marketing in North America, where diversity is really at the center of that conversation, as we know, for consumer goods companies in particular. I spent my previous almost 13, 14 years in the technology services industry in a variety of different business and HR roles. So I've seen a little bit from a diversity lens what the technology world looks like as well.
So happy to have you guys here. I can't even tell you. So let's start with the first question, and it's a little bit thorny. Diversity and inclusion, I worked in myself, you know, for some time, and I've evolved in my thinking around like what it really means in our industry. And so the place I've come to is I feel like it's a bit of a band-aid for a bigger societal ill or issue, right? So in your respective organizations, how are you kind of ensuring that it isn't this kind of, you know, face value kind of program, you know, programmatic thing where it's like we have a diversity and inclusion program versus making it something that is actually accountable, actionable, something in motion? How are you kind of doing that in your respective organizations?
Great. What I've found is that most people who go into this work, this is life's work, this is passion. And so you are going to be very unhappy if you find that you're boxed in and only able to window dress. I can't imagine many people who would choose to stay in an organization where they find out that that is the extent of their role. And I would also say, you know, honestly, if we think about civil rights and we think about the many sectors which work towards civil rights, you need to have people in the corporate sector, in the private sector, within organizations that are working on or fighting that inertia to just continue having people that look exactly like the people that were there in the first place.
Sure.
And you've got to be able to go into that organization, meet people where they are, but also help them understand how to have a change, have your metrics around what making a difference actually means. And when you inevitably run into roadblocks or you start to plateau on things or people become fatigued or you're not seeing an increase in leaders of different backgrounds, then you know you have to completely rework your process. So, you know, yes, it can become a band-aid, but I would argue that almost no one goes into this role okay with that.
Right. Agreed. Yeah.
You know what? It's a very profound question that you're asking. It's for Unilever, it has really been a core tenet of our business model for a very long time. We talk a lot about business as a force for good and responsible business is good business. A lot of the work that we do, the brands that we put out, have a purpose behind them, and a lot of times it's about positive social impact. The Dove campaign comes to mind, building self-esteem in young women, women of different and diverse backgrounds. So it's really very much a part of the fabric of the company and has been embedded in the business model, which makes the journey a tiny bit easier. The second thing I will say is that we have, and I can't take any credit for this, to be honest with you, but my colleagues who have driven some of this work, particularly in the US, have approached it from a lens of unconscious bias. To basically say we are human beings and we have faults, and an unconscious bias is a part of that. An important conversation, though, is to acknowledge what those unconscious biases are before we try to fix them. I think if you try to just put the band-aid on it without understanding what is the inherent problem you're trying to solve, that's when it becomes a little superficial, for lack of a better term. And the last and most important thing, I think, is embedding it into the culture and not just looking at it purely as a set of metrics that you're driving after. And we've done this not just here in the US, but in Africa, for example, where race relations take a whole new meaning. So it's how do you embed it in the culture? How do you role model it? Is really what leaves that lasting effect, rather than creating processes or matrices that may not pan out.
Both of you touch on two salient points, which, you know, one of them is, I've always argued, it's a very top-down thing. If you don't have the C-suite behind you, you will never succeed. You will always have an uphill battle. You'll always be looking for money to pilot and do things that you want to do, and it doesn't become useful in that way. So I'm glad that you drove that home. So the second question I have is, you know, we've been focused on diversity and inclusion, but there's also this aspect of equity that I think we haven't spent a lot of time on. So it's one thing to say we want to diversify our workforce so that it starts to mirror what society looks like. And then it's another thing to say, well, we will include them, right? And it's a very separate thing when we start to talk about, well, we've got diversity. Maybe we've solved for that. Maybe we've solved for the assimilation factor. But once they're there, what are we doing with them? And my sense is, from the organizations that I've served, is that people are maybe getting in, and people are maybe even being included, but then there's a plateau. And so, like, they're not being promoted, they're not seeing those same opportunities, they're not being paid equitably. So in your opinion, where does equity kind of fall into line with your respective strategies within your organization? Like, how are you kind of solving for that?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, one thing I want to say is, I actually want to rewind for 1 second because I think it's an important foundation for this question of equity. And I want to touch on something that Harsha said that I think is really important. So you need the leadership support. You also need the business support. And the reason that diversity so often can become seen as this band-aid is actually almost never through intention, but really through a failure to get out of a silo and really integrate with the business. And that goes for everything from who you hire to how you include and how you create an equitable workplace for other people. The onus is not on business managers, hiring managers, and nothing changes. And so it behooves us to help those, to not only help those business managers understand the context, but also make sure they have some skin in the game.
Sure. You're right. It's one thing to track metrics, another thing to make sure that people feel included and that they can actually bring their whole self to work. A couple of ways in which we've brought that to life at Unilever is this idea that every voice matters and every story needs to be celebrated. It's sort of our little sort of, I don't want to call it a tagline because it's so much more than that. And we really believe in it. Our efforts around building culture, particularly here in the Unilever USA, have been around that, and it's really, it resonates with people because what we're doing for them is giving them a voice, usually through business resource groups and events where they feel comfortable speaking up, making them feel like this is a safe place for them to say what they want to say. So I think that's one way in which we're kind of building that inclusivity in the workforce. I think the other piece around equity, that's where I think process can help. It's one of those places where process is almost more important than just having a culture around it. Having a set of checks and balances in your processes, whether that's performance management, talent management, reward management, to ensure that there is no group in the organization that gets unfairly disadvantaged, is something that Unilever has actually been doing for years. It's behind the scenes, and it's ironic. I often tell people this is one of the beauties of being in HR, is you don't actually see the work that we do on a daily basis, but that's where I actually do think that process can help in driving equity.
there are a number of degrees to what inclusion really means, right?
Right.
So the way we operationalize inclusion is one, we're teaching individuals across the company how to be more inclusive, understanding unconscious bias, understanding how to be an inclusive manager, an inclusive team, understanding how to be an ally. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's one pillar. There's another pillar around belonging. So that includes the employee groups.
I noticed you said that before.
Spaces.
I like that.
I read a quote, actually I should credit Fern Mandelbaum, who shared this quote with me. She's at Stanford GSB, but that of course we know the quote, like, diversity is being invited to the party, inclusion is being asked to dance, and then belonging is dancing like no one is watching.
Yeah, totally.
Right?
Love that.
That's another thing where you just feel that free liberty to express who you fully are.
Yeah.
And then on the equity piece, 100% agree, it's process. So there are a number of scenes we do where we look at our compensation equity. We send it off to a third party to look at any statistical differences for people. We look at our performance ratings and the groupings of those ratings by different groups, including things like age,
right?
So all of those checks and balances, we're constantly finding areas where we could manage and use data in some cases to see if there are groups that are having a different experience, of course, in addition to our employee survey where we ask people if they feel like it.
Sure. Awesome. You're doing great work. But what are some of your challenges? Where are the pockets where you still find yourself like, what aren't we doing right in your respective businesses?
You mentioned before, you know, that uphill battle, and it is an uphill battle by definition, because people want to work with who they're comfortable with. They don't want to redefine the criteria for how they select and advance people. We have a default. We have all kinds of ways that we trust who we already know or people like us, right? So there are uphill battles even within individuals. But there are a host of other challenges. So one of the things is diversity is such a broad term. And if you start to define diversity in certain ways with certain demographics, that can generate and harbor, you know, some, you know, antagonistic feelings for others who are like, wait a minute, you know, I was the first person in my family to go to college, and just because I don't fit in this category, I'm not diverse. Of course, that's not true, right? Diversity is contextual. Diversity is, by definition, different people. But because of programs that have to focus, you know, we have to have focus in certain areas across our different programs, there's a huge issue around comprehension,
right?
A perception of lack of being unfair.
Mm-hmm.
At Pinterest, we have public hiring goals around some of the diversity of severely underrepresented groups across the tech workforce.
Okay.
Those hiring goals are often perceived as quotas that then essentially make our standards for our interview process and the qualifications, they feel irrelevant to people.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, we know how to hire great people. We have the same set of criteria across every hire, but people will automatically assume that some people have certain advantages. There's also fatigue around the conversation around diversity, which is related to both of the things that I just mentioned.
Sure.
Right? Thinking that it's for someone else, that it's for other. We've had this conversation already. Like, even just this week, I was reading articles talking about how, you know, people are blaming things on racism to an excessive degree, and using examples that actually do contain elements of racism, given the historical U.S. context, but saying that it's being
overblown
into certain situations.
Yeah.
It's uncomfortable to talk about. I mean, there are a host of challenges.
Yeah, thank you.
Our challenges at Unilever are no different. I mean, it's part of it is the system that we operate in, right? So it's sort of like almost a self-fulfilling prophecy. When you're trying to attract a certain combination of people into that is representative of the workforce, it isn't that simple. I don't think the U.S. educational system and the infrastructure that we have provides access to the right combination of individuals. So there are systemic issues that go beyond the Pinterest and Unilevers of the world that we are having to sort of fight, right? And it's not just in the U.S. Unilever is a global company. We are operating 40, 50 countries, and we have problems of this type in different ways in different markets. That's one issue. And I think the other is, really, how do we ensure that we have the right voices around the table? You know, we're talking a lot right now at Unilever about this idea of team composition. It's one thing to have the demographics, but how do you make sure that when the decisions are being made, mm-hmm. the right voices are around the table? And it goes so far beyond demographics. It's diversity of thought, diversity of educational background, diversity of everything. But the common theme, I think, is this idea that, you know, your voice matters, and that if you come and work for Unilever, your voice will be heard. That's really been our call to action, and it has helped us. But we have a long way to go. But I don't think our challenges are any different than other organizations.
So you guys kind of hinted on it. I sense there's got to be a challenge in serving the vast and growing groups of marginalized people. What are some of your pain points or thoughts around, you know, is there really a way currently here in 2018 to serve the myriad of groups that keep cropping up as so-called marginalized, right? So as to say, like, can you be serving the interests of African Americans at the same time that you're servicing Latinos and differently abled and veterans and everything else that continue, you know, like on and on and on? There may be others that crop up before the year's end. What are your senses around that? Because there's a sentiment that you cannot actually be 100% successful in serving all those needs across those various groups.
Yeah, I mean, we're not 100% successful at serving the needs of probably any employee. I mean, if you really think about it, and this is business, right?
Right.
Everybody's an individual, and, you know, I think also going back to the systemic way, people learn differently. Mm-hmm. Different education systems expect people to learn in very similar ways, which is not necessarily serving the needs of individuals. And so while you do need focus areas to accomplish anything, and different groups, I mean, it's infinite, right? The number of groups that identify as distinct or as marginalized, it's completely contextual. You know, while we're far smaller and less global than Unilever, we do operate in multiple countries and markets around the world. Mm-hmm. So what constitutes marginalized? I mean, it's really a kind of vast, infinite question that is completely contextual depending on society and the way that we evolve. But I think that if you are working in a workplace where you expect people to be the same in order to be successful, if your criteria for who is successful is narrow, which we typically do tend to see, this like regression towards a mean, then we have a problem when we're not serving lots of different people. So yeah, it's a kind of an ever-evolving conundrum to think about who might be included. If people can't raise their hand and say, hey, look, I have this type of need, what can, you know, do I have everything I need to support me? And we say no, then we clearly aren't doing our jobs.
Yeah. My view is that I think if you serve the human need, you will pretty much get everybody. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're all human beings at the end of the day. We have our own stories, our own experiences that we bring to the table. Mm-hmm. And as long as an organization respects that, problem is, you know, I know it's easier said than done, but I think it's less about groups as much as it is about looking at it broadly and thinking about the human need. And that's sort of been at the crux of our strategy at Unilever, particularly around HR, is putting the human at the center of everything we do, which is why we're anchoring our employee development and purpose and finding meaning in what you do. The rise of the individual, you know, Josh Burson talks a lot about that, that everything needs to be personalized these days. And as long as you do that, as long as you connect with them on that individual level, mm-hmm. I think it is possible to ensure that everybody's needs are met. Because I don't think the needs of the person that grew up in a village in India are that dramatically different from the one that got an Ivy League education in at Harvard. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're fundamentally that very different. Their aspirations might be a little, as long as they're able to follow their calling, whatever that might be, then I think you've embraced them and you've created that inclusivity that you want to create.
I think you touch on something important, which is in both of your cases, you're operating at a global scale,
yes.
Right? And I think if you're focused on the U.S. in specific, the language, the lexicon we have around what happens with people of color in this country is very, very unique to the U.S. When you start to try to extrapolate that across the globe, it does not add up very well, right? Because it can't be understood. You know, it is very unique to hear, and then you start to understand once you start interacting with those different markets that there really isn't much of a difference. We're all kind of operating from the same principles, the same wants, the same motivations, and so then it's like, well, what do you hang your hat on? How marginalized are we really? And so that whole point you made about addressing the human need is probably where we need to be and probably the discussion we need to be having if we're looking at things from being like a global family or a global workforce, right? But I think here in the U.S. we tend to be very ultra focused and you know, on what happens here in the U.S., almost with almost not a lens towards how we play in other places or how this is viewed in other places.
I think a lot of companies, the way that they focus on the human need is around values.
Yes.
And it's understanding what our values are. So, for example, at Pinterest, one of the things we value quite a lot is curiosity, right? And, you know, we look for people who have different interests, for example, and are able to leverage those interests in different ways to certain work problems. Mm-hmm. We have a value called to knit, which is not literally knitting, mm-hmm. but around, you know, aiming people with different backgrounds on a single problem, right?
Mm.
And getting the best that we can, which is really the advantage of diversity, right? Is that innovation. Essentially, if you know, we find people that share that value system, mm-hmm. who have those universal needs of wanting to do a great job, wanting to be recognized, wanting to be able to find flow in their work, which are some of the universal things that people are looking for at work, then we won. Where we get into an issue around some of the different needs 100% right, is let's say someone you know has a vision impairment, right? Did we create the same type of environment that person needed to be fully successful?
Right.
And a lot of organizations don't have that yet, right?
Agreed.
So it's a matter of, you know, those types of things to help people do their best work.
Absolutely.
Where I think organizations have to go.
There's been a lot of discussion, particularly on social media, around, you know, what does it mean to work while being black, or work while being a person of color, or even a woman of color? What is that experience like? What is your sense about that as a dialogue? And is there a unique experience that people of color have in the workforce from your perspective? And does it require, in your opinion, some exploration? You know, I mean, it really, in some regards, we're talking cultural sensitivity, right? So the fact that people are coming in with a different lens based on the cultural context of wherever they've grown up and that kind of thing. So I'd be interested in your opinion on that.
Well, if you can't come to work again and feel safe, if you feel like you know, the concept of covering, right, that you have to cover certain elements of who you are in order to be successful because somehow people have decided that who you are makes you less competent at your job, then it does become relevant. You know, for example, a lot of people in some companies cover being older because, you know, young people are favored. Sometimes it happens vice versa, where younger people will not reveal their age, right? So if you feel like there's a part of you that is inherently you that you have to erase in some way in order to be successful, then it becomes relevant at work and is psychologically damaging.
Mm.
I don't think it has to be that way. I think there are organizations where people flourish across their backgrounds, and that's part of why we try to create the belonging. You know, I want any employee to be able to raise their hand and say, look, from my perspective, you know, if I look at our skin tone range feature, was essentially, look, when I search on Pinterest for beauty, I'm not seeing people that look like me. And having the safety to raise your hand and say, look, I'm a black woman, and I searched for hairstyles, and nobody had my hair texture. Like, as long as we have that ability, and we can go in and change that, then you can flourish. So I think that's where the conversation starts to become relevant.
Yeah.
And should be explored.
Right.
It's a bit of a catch-22, right? I'm an Indian American, and when I come to work, if I don't see people like me in positions of power or more of them around me, I'm never going to feel comfortable being my normal self. So I think it boils down to whatever ethnic group you might belong to. I think if you are in an environment where you are a significant minority, the chances that you will feel out of place or you will feel like I can't bring my whole self to work is natural. I mean, we all, role modeling is so important in this space. I mean, you've got to have something to aspire to. And that's really what it boils down to. And that's true whether you're African-American, you're Latino, you're Asian-American, wherever you come from. It's about, do I feel comfortable? Are there enough people like me around that so I can be myself? Or is the organization giving me the room to be who I am? Mm-hmm. Is the culture heavily driven by a certain group or the other? And the truth is, no matter how hard you try, there are microcultures in every organization, right? Where if you go to a certain part of Unilever, you are likely to be surrounded by a certain kind of people just because of the geographical location. And if you are the lone expat there, you're going to feel a little bit out of place. But it's about how easily the organization is embracing you and your individuality, which I think matters. So for me personally, that's really always been my journey. I've been fortunate. I don't think I've felt dramatically different or uncomfortable in my skin. But there have been moments when I have, and I think it also comes with age and experience that you learn to get comfortable with who you are and say, so what? But it takes time. I mean, there have been moments when I've felt totally fine and moments when I've not.
Same here. I think, and especially too, working in the tech space in specific, I know for me, you know, more often than not, walking into events, it's me. I see somebody like yourself or you, and it's that, you know, that there's that glimpse like, hey, hey girl, you know, kind of thing. And so it speaks to that need to be able to see yourself in those spaces. But to your point, I think, you know, with time and maybe some maturity and some other experiences, I think you learn to just kind of stand. I think that ability to stand as an individual and own the fact, yes, I'm a woman of color, and yes, I may be the only one here, but you know what? I'm going to carve out that space for myself, even if it doesn't exist, and be that. And hopefully by doing that, I open up the space for other people to come, right? And I think that's part of where we should be in terms of diversity and inclusion is really looking towards paving the way for the next.
You know, going back to what I was, you know, mentioning before about, you know, when we pick a workplace, right, we negotiate a number of things, right? So, you know, even things as basic as dress code, right? Maybe you wish you could go to work in your pajamas, but we get it. You know, you have to go to work, you have to wear a certain something, and, you know, there are certain norms at work that you're willing to trade off and that are not psychologically damaging in any way, because you're like, okay, great, I can't wear my slippers, I'll be fine, right? And then there are these things that you cannot trade off. The ability to express who you are, your style, right? The ideas that you have, it's that dancing like no one's watching when you're contributing to an idea or a meeting. And you are finding that you have to do that, but other people don't, right? That creates a real psychological cost. And that's not a workplace that I want to be in.